श्री रामकृष्ण प्रभ चैनल नु चूडंडी मासपत्रिकनु चदवंडी।
नमस्त्री यतिराजाय विवेकानंद सूरये सचित सुख स्वरूपाय स्वामिनी तापहारिणी। Enslaving the king of the universe is a topic we'll be discussing about today. Who is the king of the universe? God. How to enslave him? Okay. In our culture, God realization has another name, that is freedom, mukti, absolute freedom. So to enslave God means to enslave that which is absolutely free. Is it ever possible? Is it not contradiction in terms to talk of enslaving something which is absolutely free and eternally free? What is our definition of God? Our definition of God is free, mukta. When you say somebody is a mukta purusha, a liberated individual, he is not bound by any law, he is not under anybody. And now today we are talking about enslaving the king of the universe, enslaving the absolutely free, enslaving that power which doesn't know what slavery is. Is it possible? Yes. With what you can enslave the king of the universe? With bhakti, with devotion. Devotion has that power. Nothing else has that power. Are there any examples? Yeah, many examples are there in our culture. We have enslaved God. God has become their slave, as it were. We have discussed many examples from Srimad Bhagavatam. Examples like Prahlada and Kuchela. Today we shall take up some examples from Srimad Ramayana. We all heard about the great devotee of Rama, Shabari, the tribal woman who waited and waited and waited for Rama for years together, practically for entire life, because her guru told her that Rama would come to you one day. Rama would come to your humble hut one day. He did not tell her which year, after how many years he would come. Just he told that Rama would come to you one day. And she waited for life. Towards the fag end of life, Rama went to her hermitage and blessed her. Shabari was a tribal woman. She was the daughter of a tribal chieftain. So to marry her, the leader of the tribes hunted many animals. He laid trap, caught many wild animals, wild boars, wild deers, many other animals that are available in the forest. So he tied them up in the place where he wanted to marry his daughter off. Shabari saw all these animals tied to posts there, and she inquired why all these animals have been brought from the forest. People told that your marriage is very near. Your father wanted to give a feast on the occasion of your marriage by killing these animals. The animals would serve as food for the guests who would come for your marriage. They say she ran away from her village, and then she came to the place where Ratnakara, the future Valmiki Maharshi, where he was doing tapas. You know the story of Ratnakara also. He was a bandit, a robber in the forest, who kill people, loot people of their belongings, and then he would support his family. He was a pious Brahmin before. His father sent him to fetch kusha grass and fagots for doing yajnas. He came into the forest. There he saw a tribal woman, Nishada woman, fell in love with her, married her, and got introduced to all the vices, like drinking and eating meat. Okay, Nishada woman, for her actually, this is the normal food. She would live in forest. But because he married her, slowly got introduced to all these things. And how to support the family in the forest? He had 10 children by her, and how to support those many children? So, he would deprive people of their belongings. He turned into a bandit, a robber, and whoever would pass through the forest, he would attack them, kill them, loot them. If they offer assistance, he would kill them, otherwise he would take away their belongings. That's how actually he is living. One day, the sages happened to pass through the same patch of forest, and he attacked them and beat them up. And the sages were annoyed with him. Such a tremendous sinful activity this is. This is not a right livelihood. So you will be incurring a lot of sin. Are you ready to bear the consequences of your sinful actions? And then Ratnakara says, only 1/12 of the actions, sinful sin, will come upon me. The rest will be borne by family members. So is that true? Then go and ask your family members whether they would like to take part, you know, whether they would like to experience or enjoy a part of the sin of your deeds. So he went and asked his wife. She said, you are the owner of the family, you are my husband, it's your responsibility to feed us, to provide for. So I have nothing to do with your sin. I am not going to take a part of your sin. He asked his children, they said, we have nothing to do with your sin. He asked his parents, old parents, they also told, why would we take your sin? Your karma, and you will have to experience how you bring money, how you bring the things that are needed so to keep us alive. That's your responsibility. So none of us, we will not take part in your sin, they said. So Ratnakara was disappointed. Deep dispassion developed in him. He came back to the sages. He tied them actually to different trees because they would not stay till he comes back. So he tied them to the trees and went to his family to ask them. And then they, out of his compassion, their compassion for him, they introduced him, initiated him into Rama Mantra. And he was so unlearned, he could not even pronounce Rama. He would utter Mara, Mara. But when you continuously utter Mara, Mara, it would become Rama. So there's no difference. That's how actually Ratnakara went about doing penance and tapas. He did such intense penance and tapas. So an anthill grew over him. We know the story. An anthill grew over him. And this Sabari, she used to attend to Ratnakara in the beginning. When he was not completely immersed in sadhana, you know, in the beginning days of the sadhana, he would do japa and then he would go for fruits and roots to eat a little. In the beginning, he would take only once in a day, then afterwards, once in 3 days, once in 5 days, once in a week, and slowly, slowly he reduced his food. And then he became completely absorbed in meditation. So Sabari used to attend on Ratnakara, according to one of the legends. You know, these legends are legends, you know, there are many stories in yogic lores. If you look for authenticity of these stories, you will not really get. So we just take the story part and what is the moral that we can learn from the story. So she used to attend on him. When the sages initiated Ratnakara with Rama Mantra, and she happened to hear that mantra, so she also started repeating Rama Mantra. So wherever actually somebody utters Rama's mantra sincerely, Hanuman would be there. Hanuman will go there. And so when she used to roam in the forest and then used to chant with Rama's name, not like Ratnakara. Ratnakara would sit and at one point and he would do the Rama mantra. But she would roam across the forest and she would keep on chanting Rama, 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 Rama. She would dance and then, because she was only a small girl, Sabari. So she was accompanied by a small monkey. That small monkey was none other than Hanuman. And so that Hanuman actually used to protect her all the time from other wild animals and things. So she was repeating mantra like that. Afterwards, Narada came to Ratnakara. Narada called out to Ratnakara, "You have done enough penance. You have had the vision of the Lord. You have become a blessed devotee of the Lord. So now you go to the north and you go to Badrikashrama, some ashrama, Narada says, Ratnakara. You go there and write Ramayana. The Lord Sri Mahavishnu incarnated on earth, was born as the son of Dasaratha. You write the account of the Lord, your life will become further blessed. So you have attained Siddhi now. So all these great scriptures have come only from the Rishis. Okay, only Rishis can write actually such extraordinary poems, extraordinary stories. An ordinary human being cannot, you know, write such great scriptural works. So Ratnakara became Valmiki, and then as per the instruction of Narada, he left the place of his tapas and went to the north to write Ramayana. So what the Shabari will do now, because Ratnakara has gone, she doesn't have to attend on him anymore. And so she was repeating Rama's name, and Narada instructed her also, "You're repeating God's name, it's okay, it's fine, it is efficacious. But more efficacious it would be if you take actually a mantra from a guru." So telling thus, Narada asked her, "You go to Matanga Maharshi, his hermitage is nearby. That Maharshi is very kind and very compassionate. He would not look into your caste and other things. He would initiate you into Rama Mantra. So you go to him and request him, and he will initiate you into mantra. And you repeat that mantra, your life will become blessed." That was the instruction Narada had given to Shabari. So Shabari went to the hermitage of Matanga Maharshi, but he had many disciples. But all those disciples knew by then that this was a mad tribal woman. They knew Shabari as a mad tribal woman because she would just chant Rama's name and just roam about in the forest, jumping here and there. And so they all branded her as a mad woman. She would go into ecstasies now and then. They knew her only as this, that actually a mad woman accompanied by a small monkey. They did not know that monkey was none other than Hanuman. So she wanted to have initiation as per the instructions of Narada, but the disciples of Matanga Maharshi never allowed her inside the ashrama. So they drove her off with the sticks, "Don't come this side again, don't come into the campus at all again." So they drove her off. And how to please the sage, then how to approach the sage, how to get initiated, that was her desire. So what she would do, early morning she would go near the hermitage. Before anybody would wake up, she would go and wash the precincts, clean the precincts. And then up to the Pampa Sarovar, from lake to Pampa Sarovar, where actually Matanga Maharshi would take his bath, she would clean that pathway also, she would shower flowers and she would remove all the stones. So it would make the path as smooth as possible. Before the dawn breaks, she would do all this. So one day Matanga Maharshi saw all this. The hermitage, the campus is so neat and clean. Somebody is putting cleaning every day. "Who is doing this?" he asked his disciples. "Are any of you actually doing, getting up before the sunrise and doing all this?" They said, "No, we are not doing this." "Then who is doing?" "We don't know," they said. Because she would go before the sunrise and would complete the work. And then he told them, "Find out who is doing this and bring that individual into my presence." So one day what they did, they woke up very early. They wake up dead of the night and they climbed the nearby trees to find out who is doing all this. Shabari, as usual, went around 2:30 in the night and was doing all the work. And they wanted to catch her, bring her to the presence, into the presence of the sage Matanga. But they would not. So because now they saw who was doing this. So the next morning they reported to the sage that this mad tribal woman, Nishada woman, is doing all this. So because she is Nishada woman, we don't want to go near her. So we have not brought her to you. Then Matanga Maharshi, because he was a sage, he divined why she was actually doing all this. Then he came to know that it was Narada Maharshi who instructed her to take initiation from him. Then he told his disciples, she is not a mad woman, she is not an ordinary woman, she is an exceptional devotee of the Lord. Bring her into my presence tomorrow. So because the sage was very firm in giving this instruction, the disciples had no option but to obey his order. The next day, they actually went to her and brought her into the presence of the sage. Then he asked her to take bath in the Pampa Sarovar. He also took bath and initiated her with the Rama mantra, Sri Rama, Jaya Rama, Jaya Jaya Rama. This is Trayodaya Dashakshari mantra, a very powerful mantra. He initiated Shabari into that mantra. Since that day, Shabari started living in the hermitage. On one auspicious occasion, there was this Mahodaya. The Mahodaya means all the people were actually going to take a dip in the sea. It was a very auspicious time, you know, like Pushkara, how you do once in 12 years. You take a dip in river. Okay, that would help us wash off all your sins. Like that, there was an auspicious moment, auspicious day. All the people from all the hermitages from that Dandakaranya were going to take a dip in the sea, because that was the most auspicious moment. And most of the sages also went along with their disciples. But Matanga Maharshi's disciples also asked him, sage, would you accompany us? We are going to take a dip in the sea. Matanga Maharshi said, I have become too old now. I cannot take the trouble of traveling all the way to the sea to take a bath there now. So I have become too old. If you want to go, you go. All the disciples had gone. And he asked Shabari, would you like to go? She said, no. The feet of my guru actually is the most holy tirtha for me. Okay, there is no tirtha, there is no place which is more sacred than the lotus feet of my guru to me. So I'll worship you here. So I don't want to go to the sea, she said. And she got immersed in worshipping the feet of Matanga Maharshi. And Matanga Maharshi then blessed her with, you know, all the seas, you know, Ikshusi. Ikshusi means sugarcane juice sea. So these are all, you know, poetic way of expressing things. Where is Ikshusi? You don't ask me. So the Ikshusi, Ikshu is actually sugarcane juices. Okay, Ikshusi, then Surash sea. Sura is actually liquor, right? So if you take bath in all this, and then Kshira, then ghee. Kshira is milk sea, then ghee sea, then Dadisi. Dadisi means sea of curd. And then the sea, Lavana sea. Lavana sea is salt sea, the normal sea. And then freshwater sea. The deities of all these seas came to the hermitage and gave a holy bath to both Matanga Maharshi and Shivari. So then Matanga Maharshi became old, and then Matanga Maharshi told, I am actually the worshipper of Nirguna Nirakara Parabrahman, but the Almighty Lord had incarnated on this earth. He is actually there in Ayodhya, and he would come to our hermitage one day. But my body will not last that long. I don't have the opportunity to see and to look at the beautiful form of the Lord with this physical eyes, O Shabari. Okay? I will be departing from this world, but you have to stay back. You will see the Lord. But Shabari said, so, O sage, O Gurudeva, I cannot live without you. My life is dedicated to you. When you want to leave the world, take me also with you. I want to die with you. I want to come with you. But Matanga Maharshi persuaded her, saying that, no, I don't have the good fortune of seeing Rama, because he will be coming after a few years. I cannot wait that long. This body will not last that long. So you stay back. You stay in the world. Your life will become blessed. You wait for Rama. Saying that, the sage had given up his body. As per the instructions of her guru, Shabari was waiting for Rama. How she would wait for Rama? Every day she would go into forest. She would bring fruits, wild fruits, berries. She would taste them first. If it is sour, she will discard it. She will remove it. Every day she would collect a few sweet berries. She would taste first. Only sweet ones she would collect in that dona, small bowl, and will bring and keep in the hermitage, thinking that today my Rama would come along with Lakshmana and Sita. And before that, she would wake up in the morning and will clean the path as she used to do the Matanga Maharshi Ashrama. Every day, she would sprinkle flowers there because my Rama would be coming. Rama's would sit his foot here. And so there should not be any thorn, there should not be any pebbles or stones. And so she would keep the path as clean as possible. And she would not allow others actually to walk on this path. This path actually is for my Rama. My Rama is going to come today. And they thought actually she is a mad woman, because she already branded her mad. Every day she would say like that, and she would wait for Rama. That's how she spent her days, because her guru had given the instruction, one day Rama would come. He did not specifically tell her, okay, in which year he is going to come, on which date he is going to come. Simply told, in future Rama will come to this hermitage, you wait for, that's all. Every day. So today could be the day for my Rama to arrive at my hermitage. Suddenly, if he comes, if there is nothing in the home, hermitage, what will I offer him? So every day she would collect the berries and she would keep, and she would taste them first. Only the sweetest of the berries she would collect in the bowl and keep ready for Rama, and she would keep a garland made of wildflowers also. Today will my Rama welcome, today will my Rama welcome. That thought of Rama continuously. She was never bored thinking of Rama. Not even one day, she got disappointed. Oh, whole day I waited for Rama, my Rama did not come. Not like that. She thought, my Rama, this time he was born as a king. How many responsibilities would be there for a king? He might be busy with so many responsibilities. So that's why he could not come to my hermitage. But he would come one day, when he becomes free of all those responsibilities, he would come to my hermitage. So I will have to wait, without feeling bored ever in the least. Okay, every time the sweet thought of Rama would be there in her mind. This day he would be coming, this day he would be coming, this day he would be coming. So she, from young woman actually, she passed into middle age, from middle age to old age. The senility and the problems of old age actually almost overpowered her. But still, she never lost faith that Rama would come one day. Rama would come one day. Every day she would spend like that only. Looking at the berries, these berries are from a Rama. She would clean the pathway, my Rama would come and walk on this pathway. So that's how she spent her days, entire life, thinking about Rama and Rama and Rama. Before he passed away, he gave up his body. Matanga Maharshi told how Rama would look like. Okay, what would be his body complexion? So he says, Rajanubahu, long-armed one. Neela Meghasyama. Okay, his body complexion is like the blue cloud. He would be accompanied. So Lakshmana would be there. That would be there. So he told. So the form actually is there in her mind now. She was imagining. In her imagination, she created a form of Rama. And with that imagination, and with that form, she was meditating upon constantly. And one day, Rama did arrive. Along with Lakshmana from the northerly direction. Because he had covered many hermitages. Rama was eager to see her. Because the Lord knew actually. He had greatest devotee of. He's actually waiting for him for many years, for many, many, many years. So he wanted to bless her, he wanted to see her. With great eagerness, Rama had arrived. So that was the most joyous day for her. Her life became blessed because she compared the Rama she saw with her physical eyes with Rama that her guru, Matanga Maharshi, had described, exactly tallied. And this is my Rama. She had no doubt. Are you Rama? She did not ask. This is my Rama. What my guru told? Yes, the Rama had arrived. She was in raptures. She made him sit on a beautiful asana, both of them, brothers. And then she offered the wild berries that she had collected, you know. Every day that she would do, collecting that. The sweet wild berries she had given him. And she had given him some juice. And then she told, actually, my guru told Rama that you would come to my hermitage one day. I've been waiting for this blessed day. And Rama also was very happy to meet his beloved disciple, beloved devotee, most beloved devotee, okay, and then blessed her. So Rama and Lakshmana asked her about Matanga Maharshi, what kind of a sage he was, how he would conduct himself, what was his daily routine, everything she had told him. You see this Agnihotra. Though I don't light this Agnihotra every day, it keeps burning on its own. That's the power of my guru. So that dhoti which is there actually is still wet. many years back Matanga Maharshi passed away, but it is still wet. And this is actually Dharba. So all this Kusha grass, this is still actually the fresh. But it was collected long, many years back by my guru. It is still fresh. It did not become dry. So he extolled her guru and how great a sage he was. And then Rama and Lakshmana felt blessed and they asked her about Sita. And then Shabari told them about Sita. Sita was kidnapped by Ravana. She is in Lanka. Oh my lord. So on the other side of this Pampa Sarovar, there is that Sugriva, the king of the Vanaras. You go to him, he will help you. So this help he has done to Rama and Lakshmana. And then Rama asked, what do you want now? I want deliverance. I have seen you with my physical eyes. I don't want to see this world. I don't want to see the world again. I don't want to see the world with the eyes that have seen you, O Rama. Saying that, she burned her body in Yuvagni. The tribal woman had attained to the highest of devotion. For her sake, Rama had not come just from Ayodhya to the hermitage, Ayodhya to Dandakavana. Rama came from Vaikuntha to Dandakavana. Don't think actually Rama had incarnated to kill Ravana. Ravana to kill Ravana, Rama, it doesn't have to come from Vaikuntha. To place these sages, to place these devotees, Rama had come all the way from Vaikuntha. That would be the power of these devotees. Lord would incarnate. Lord would take a human form. To take a human form is a great trouble, no? It's a bondage, right? But he would descend. The infinite spirit would descend into matter and thought to bless his devotees. That was the power of these devotees. You know, during his exile, Rama, when he started out from Ayodhya, so all the inhabitants of Ayodhya also followed him up to the river Ganges. So Rama crossed the other rivers, Gomati and Vedavati, and then he came to the banks of the Ganges. And there he asked the people of Ayodhya, you now go back. I am not coming back to Ayodhya. It's not possible. So I have to fulfill the vow of my father. So I have to be in exile for 14 years. Afterwards, I will come back and rule you. So please, you turn back. So they went back. And there on the bank of the Ganges, when the great king of the Nishadas, Guha, when he heard that Lord had come, Rama had come, Dasharatha's son, so had come there, he actually, along with all his ministers, went to meet Rama. Because this Guha, though he was the king of Nishadas, he knew the greatness of the Lord. He had full of love and devotion for Rama. And now I get an opportunity to see Rama. And so along with his ministers, he had gone there where Rama was resting. Rama was there along with Sumantra, Lakshmana and Sita. Sumantra actually with his chariot, he brought them. And Rama was telling him to go back. Now actually up to here you have come, you go back. So Guha met Rama on the bank of the Ganges. And then Guha told Rama, he was excited at seeing Rama and said, O Lord, I place myself at your disposal. We are all your servants. Please command us. Please order us. I am your bhakta. I am your devotee. I am your follower. I am your admirer. You are my all in all. So I place my entire kingdom, all my people, all my ministers at your disposal. Please command me what you want from me. So he has brought delicious dishes to entertain Rama, Sita and Lakshmana. But Rama politely refuses, saying that I have to eat only roots and tubers as I am under a vow. I cannot eat these delicious dishes, so sorry, he said. And saying that, Rama told him, so you feed these horses. These horses have brought us from Ayodhya to this place, okay, to this river. My father is very fond of these horses, so you feed them well. So he has given them fodder and he has fed them well, these horses. And Guha was very happy and he was telling Rama, who else can have the fortune of having a person like you as his guest, O Rama. So my life is blessed, I have become blessed. So on that night, actually, Rama and Sita did not take any food. Rama just drank the water brought by Lakshmana, Ganges water, and then he was lying on the bare floor. He was lying on the bare floor. The prince who used to sleep on the softest of the cots, now he is sleeping in the forest on the bare floor. Lakshmana could not bear to see the sight. and the same with Guha and these friends. So we are habituated to hardships. We are all Nishadas. We are all tribal people. Oh, Lakshmana, see the condition of Rama. And you also can sleep. You also rest a while. We will protect you. So this is my forest. This terrain is actually very familiar to me. No enemy can come over here. Myself and my followers, my gods actually will protect you. Oh, Lakshmana, you also may sleep. And Lakshmana said, how can I sleep seeing my brother and my sister-in-law sleeping? And therefore, like this, Lakshmana found it difficult to sleep in spite of repeated requests from Guha. So Rama only drank water and slept for the night like that. And next day morning, he woke up and wanted to cross the river. You know, this story is not the Valmiki Ramayana, but that you will find in Ramacharitmanas of Goswami Tulsidas. This is a beautiful drama. So Rama comes onto the bank, is there on the bank of the river. He wanted to cross the river now. So in Valmiki Ramayana, only Guha orders a boatman to take Rama across the river. And that's all. But here in Ramacharitmanas of Tulsidas, the boatman is also a normal man. He is also the greatest devotee of the Lord. So Guha calls the boatman and boatman arrives there. Rama asks him to take us across the river. And the boatman refuses. No, I can't take you across the river. I have to wash your feet before I let you enter into my boat. Rama asks him, why? No, I heard the dust of your feet has a power to transform a stone into a woman. Because Rama actually transformed Ahalya from a stone into a woman, right? Ahalya, Shapa Vimochana. He liberated her from the curse. Because of the curse of her husband Gautama, she became a stone. And when Rama's foot touched that stone, she became transformed into a woman again. The Shapa Vimochana. She got liberated from the curse. I heard that. So a stone can become a woman. That is the power of the dust of your feet. But my boat is actually made of wood. Okay, wood is not as hard as stone. If you are the dust of the feet of your feet can transform a stone into a woman, I don't know what it would get transformed into my boat. But this is the only source of livelihood for me. Suppose you get transformed into some woman or something else, I will lose my livelihood. Okay, how I will support my family? So I cannot allow you to step into my boat without first washing your feet. I will have to wash in such a way that there is not even a trace of dust, not even one particle of dust on your feet. That's how I want to wash. So you just need how many pitchers of water is necessary. So he was stubborn, he would not listen. Lakshmana was annoyed. What is this man actually delaying us? Rama smiled and looked at Sita and Lakshmana. Because the Lord knew about his great devotee. How much of devotion this boatman has for Rama, only Rama knows and the boatman knows. Not even Lakshmana, not even Guha. So the boatman insists that actually I need to worship your feet. I need to wash your feet. Okay, you don't have to give me any boat fare. Okay, free. Okay, free boat ride I will give you, Rama, but I will have to wash your feet. So he insists. Rama says, okay. Then he brings water in a wooden pitcher. And he washes and washes. So you know, in Hindi heartland, when they comment on this incident, they would narrate in different ways. They dramatize it so many ways. Kevat prasang, they say. How the boatman helped Rama cross the river. What drama happened between the Lord and his devotee. And so much of drama, actually. So much. So I'm not describing everything that they hear. But he insisted that he wanted to, that Rama first, he wanted to clean his feet. And they say that when actually one foot, actually you will ask Rama to raise the foot a bit, and when Rama actually raised the foot, he would wash that foot, and Rama again would put it on the floor, and then he would clean the other foot, and then actually in the meanwhile this foot actually got soiled with mud, and then he insists on cleaning it again and again. like that Rama, Lakshmana got terribly annoyed, but he collected many pitchers of water. Many times he cleaned the feet of the Lord, and then actually he collected all the water in his pitchers. While this drama was going on, it is again there only in Ramacharitmanas, not in Valmiki Ramayana, Mother Ganga was looking at the toenails of Rama. because those toenails are the place of our origin. Mother Ganga has another name, Vishnupadi, the river that originated from the feet of Lord Vishnu. And she knew that actually this is the feet of Lord Vishnu, and she considered herself blessed because that was the place of her origin. She was looking intently at the toenails of Rama, where now she got the opportunity to worship the toenails of Rama, to look at the toenails of Rama constantly because of this boatman. The drama was going on. So first he would wash this feet, and then again this feet, and again so this foot got soiled, and again he will wash that foot, like that went on drama. And after collecting enough water, he sprinkled that water on his head and considered himself blessed. He sprinkled a little water on his family members also. And then actually he gave Tarpana, and all his pitris also, his forefathers also got liberated because of that act of his. Okay? Mother Ganga was looking at the feet of Rama, and this feet is Rama's. Okay? That which actually blessed Rama, put his foot on the head of Bali and blessed him. And that foot actually, now he got an opportunity to wash that. And also, in three measures actually he covered the entire universe. You know that Vamana Avatara, when he incarnated as Vamana, dwarf. So in three measures, in three, he covered the entire earth and also the whole cosmos. And now when he washed the feet of the Lord, it's as good as actually you cleaned the entire universe. So this boatman had that fortune, and Mother Ganga was looking at the fortune of this boatman. And when ultimately Rama entered the boat, and Lakshmana breathed easy, drama is over now. So he took them across, and when they landed on the other shore, other bank, and now Rama wanted to give him the boat fare. He asked him, "You take your boat fare." So Sita, Mother Sita, pulled out her finger ring and was about to give that to boatman. After all, a boatman, right? How much you would get money for a per day earnings, you just seen. Here, a diamond-studded finger ring Mother Sita was giving her him. But he refused. He said, "No. I have become blessed, Rama. I got the best majburi, the best boat fare that I could ever hope for, I expect. Please bless me with devotion. That's enough." A boatman, a poor man. He could have asked for riches, he could have taken that finger ring, he would have become very rich by that. No. He said, "I have got the best of the boat fare ever I could ever hope for. Vidhata, Brahma actually has granted me today that boat fare. So because of the good fortune of worshipping your feet, Lord, I have become blessed. I have no other desire. I don't want anything from you. If you want to give something to me, you can give it to me while you come back from on your return journey," he said. But now Rama never returned the same path. That means what? This boatman made Rama indebted to him. Okay? He helped him cross the river. He did not take boat fare. Rama wanted to give something, that finger ring, but he did not take. That's the greatness of devotion. For you and me, for all the people around, he was only a trolley boatman. But his heart was full of devotion for the Lord. That's why Lord had come physically in front of him and allowed him to wash his feet. And Rama knew the blessing. Rama knew the greatness of boatman. He did not seek riches. Had he sought riches, Rama would have given him. Rama would have made him the king of the entire earth if at all he had sought. But he did not. Because that is actually the kind of fulfillment, the sense of fulfillment you would get and you would feel when you have true devotion for the Lord. The external condition, the external status, how rich you are, how educated you are, everything becomes secondary. Because your experience of life is so great, even the kingship of the entire earth, you will consider as a mere trifle. Your experience of life, you feel so joyous from within when you have that highest devotion. You will not have any craving for power, you will not have any craving for money. What is that experience of life? Only those devotees know. You and I cannot know unless and until we attain to the same degree of devotion. He made the Lord indebted to him because he did not take boat fare. Rama insisted, Lakshmana insisted, Mother Sita insisted, "You take something, save something." No, he refused. "I got the best of the boat fare," he said. Don't think he's an ordinary boatman. A very rare, extraordinary, in good fortune. An individual who has got extraordinary good fortune and extraordinary blessing of the Lord will get that kind of devotion. Because after all, Lord is staying where? In your heart. When you have devotion, you will know Him. You will touch Him. Nothing else. The whole world will become, you know, Goshpada. It's a small mud puddle for that individual because the individual is experiencing the infinite. They will not theorize. They will not intellectualize their experience. Experience is an experience. Intellectually, the experience, I can't make you understand what that experience is. Few words, actually. What is intellect? Few words. I will say, my, this experience is like this. Will you understand that experience? You will not. And so you have to obtain the experience for yourself. There is no other way. And how you will get devotion? By reading the stories of the devotees of the Lord. That is the only way. It is told in Srimad Bhagavatam. So by listening to the stories of the devotees of the Lord, by reading their stories again and again, a little devotion would be kindled in course of time. So that's why actually the devotional scriptures are not ordinary scriptures. They have a lot of potency in them. You need to read them. You need to read them. So this is the kind of devotion that this boatman had attained. So another example in Ramayana, we all know. Okay? The Ramadasa. The individual who had attained to the highest devotion of the Lord, Hanuman. Hanuman. Ramayana was over. Mother Sita was brought back to Ayodhya. Rama was ruling Ayodhya. Many years passed. So Rama wanted to felicitate other kings who had assisted him, who helped Bharata to rule the kingdom well. And he called out all these Vanaras also. Sugriva's army who helped him across the sea to reach Lanka. So he felicitated all the kings. He had given them generous gifts and he sent them off. And afterwards, he felicitated all these Vanaras because they helped him to reach to Lanka. So he had given ornaments, he had given fruits and everything to all these Nala, Neela, Jambavan, Sushena. So all other Vanaras, Angada. And now Angada and Hanuman, actually, Rama felicitated specially and had given the ornaments to them. Rama put the necklace that he was wearing in his neck across the neck of Hanuman. Hanuman came and circumambulated Rama and then told Lord. So Rama wanted to know his desire. See, may I have only one desire, that I want to become immortal. I want to be here in physical embodiment, in this physical form, as long as your story is told on earth. As long as your story is there on the earth, I want to live that long. I want to be here. And Rama blessed him. Okay, the desire of you will be fulfilled, O Hanuman. And Hanuman had another desire. He said that Apsaras need to extol your glory, need to sing your glories and sing your story for me. And Rama said, okay, granted, that would happen. You will be here. So that's why actually it is the belief here in this culture that wherever actually Ramakatha is going on, anybody whoever actually is doing Sapta or Navaha, so there Hanuman will appear in some form. You might go there in a human form, or you might go there a monkey, or you might go there a bird, or you might go there as some other animal also. You can't recognize that this is Hanuman, but Hanuman is there for sure. Okay, Hanuman is there for sure. Many people would be there. He would sit like some old man. You don't understand him. This is Hanuman. Because he is just like any other human being. It's not easy. You won't, but Hanuman is there for sure. So he is immortal. So these are all actually, you know, if you use intellect and, you don't understand through reason. When it comes to bhakti, actually, you know, don't use so much of reason. So Hanuman will be there for sure. Wherever Ramakatha, whoever is singing the Ramakatha with the devotion, Hanuman will go there. So that is actually the blessing actually Hanuman wanted. And Rama said, Rama became emotional. He embraced Hanuman and said, Ekaikasyopakarasya, that he said before, Ekaikasyopakarasya, Dasyami pranantekape, Seshasyehopakaranam bhavami runino vayam. when Hanuman actually declared the news of Sita's well-being in Lanka to Rama, Rama embraced that time, and that time he told this: for the good news that you broke to me, for the benefit that you have done to me now, ekaikasya upakarasya, for this benefit that you have done to me, pranandasyami tekape, I will give my life to you, Hanuman. Seshasiha upakaranam, for all that you are going to do in future, bhavami runino vayam, I will be indebted to you. So this is the greatness of these devotees who could make the Lord indebted to him. Eternally indebted to Rama, eternally. So Lord wants to have the balance, you know, all the time, you know. No indebtedness to anybody, because that is bondage. You know, today's our topic is enslaving the king of the universe. So these devotees enslaved the Lord. Lord is in debt. They put him in debt. The Lord's own words, seshasiha upakaranam, for whatever that are going to do in future, bhavami runino vayam, I will be indebted to you, O Hanuman. I have not enough to compensate for you, for all the help that you have done. So the Lord actually felt that I can't compensate you adequately for all that you have done to me. So I am eternally indebted to you. That's how actually Hanuman, Rama, not an ordinary good fortune. Attaining yoga, attaining becoming free is much easier than to attain this parabhakti, than to keep the Lord of the universe indebted to you, to make the Lord of the universe slave of you. In Srimad Mahabhagavatam also, the story of Ambarisha, there only the Lord said these great words actually. Aham bhakta paradhino asatantrahi vidvija. Aham bhakta paradhino, I am the slave of my devotees, I don't have freedom. Asvatantrahi vija. My devotees are free, they have same-sightedness, but I don't have same-sightedness, the Lord says. I am partial to my devotees. My devotees have the same-sightedness. They look upon all as equals, because they see my manifestation everywhere. They don't make distinction, this is superior, this is inferior, this is a good man, this is a bad man. They have the same-sightedness, but I don't have. I am partial to my devotees. Aham bhakta paradhino. The devotees actually make me their slaves. They will deprive me of my freedom. Naham atmanam ashase madbhaktaihi sadubhihi vina sriyam cha atyantikim brahman esham gatir aham para. I don't love myself as much, or neither I love myself nor I love my divine consort Lakshmi as much as I love my devotees. Devotees. You don't have to love the devotee of the Lord. If you love the devotees, then you will become dear to the Lord. That is the level of self-effacement that Lord has. That's what happened in Ambarisha Upakhyana, you know. The Lord did not withdraw the Sudarshana Chakra. He did not withdraw his weapon from Durvasa. He said, go and fall at the feet of my devotee Ambarisha. Durvasa was a Brahmin and also a great sage. And Ambarisha was a Kshatriya. There such distinctions are not maintained. Whoever has great devotion for me, I am partial to him. He is my devotee, means what? I am his slave. So I can't withdraw this Sudarshana. Means you go and plead with Ambarisha. So Durvasa comes and falls at the feet of Ambarisha. And Ambarisha then prays to that. Discuss of the Lord. Weapon of the Lord, and then actually Sudarshana comes back to the Lord. So don't underestimate. There actually a beautiful instruction was given to Durvasa. See, these tapasic, these siddhis that you have acquired through tapas and through penance, where you have to use them? We have to use them on my devotees. You can't, you should not. Being a sage, you must know where to use the siddhis, where to use the powers. You can use this powers against a Rakshasa, but you can't use this powers against the Bhagavatuttama, the greatest devotee of mine. Even in the Mahabharata also, Duryodhana always used to accuse Krishna of partiality. You are partial to the Pandavas. Okay? You are my relative also. See, Kauravas and the Pandavas, both are actual relatives of Krishna only, right? The Pandavas are related to Krishna. Kauravas, are they not related to Krishna? they are also related to Krishna. But why do you love the Pandavas more than you love us? That was the question he had in his mind, Duryodhana. Yes, Krishna says, I am partial to the Pandavas. Why? Because they are with dharma. Dharma is my very form. The Lord says, Pandavaihi dharmacharivihi ekatyam mam gatam viddi. They have become one with me. These Pandavas have become one with me. These five Pandavas are like five pranas to me. That's what he says to Duryodhana. You have ill-treated them. You have humiliated them. You have tried to kill them. You have done violence to them from very childhood. Not now, when Krishna goes to him to deliver his message. This is what he says. Yasthan dveshti samam dveshti yasthan an samam anu. Whoever hates the Pandavas, they hate me. Whoever loves Pandavas, whoever follows the Pandavas, they follow me. Krishna did not mince words. Duryodhana was telling, if you are the Lord actually, you should have the same-sightedness, you should love us as much as you love the Pandavas. How can a God be partial being? God should not be partial, but Krishna did not mince words. Yes, I am partial, he says. I love them more than I love you. Because you hate them, the people who actually follow righteousness, who are with dharma. You hate me, in fact. Then how can I love somebody who hates me? That's what the Lord says. I can't love you. If you make them your enemy, then you are my enemy too. And when Duryodhana asks him, actually, be our guest today and take food with us, Krishna refuses. I can't take food in your house. I have not delivered my message yet. And he says, Duryodhana says, but I am not your enemy. Yes, you are my enemy, Krishna says. You have made Pandavas your enemy. Whoever actually makes Pandavas their enemy, they are my enemy too. And he refuses to take food in the palace of Duryodhana and he goes to Vidura, the humble cottage of Vidura. The Lord had his food there the night. Bhishma invited him to his house. Drona invited to his house. Bahlika invited him to his house. Krishna refused. He said, as good as I have come to your house and I have taken your prasad and your worship, please go back to your houses. Now I am going to Vidura. He declares this to Duryodhana and then goes to Vidura straight. And he accepts the hospitality of Vidura, but he refuses the hospitality of Duryodhana. That is the power of devotion. How much devotion Vidura had for Krishna in his heart, only Vidura knew and the Lord knew. Maybe a few others like Bhishma knew. Bhishma invited Krishna to come to his house. Krishna politely refused. But when he said that I am going to the house of Vidura, Bhishma understood that this great devotee of the Lord. Lord is going to the right place only. Drona also could understand. So they did not press the Lord further that please come to our houses. So this is the power of devotion. You can enslave the Lord, the free. The Lord has, through his own utterances, he told many times that I am not equal to all, I am partial to my devotees, I am their slave. So, how great devotion is now, you understand? You all have, we all have the privilege of becoming the devotees of the Lord. If you become a true devotee of the Lord, whether you know it or not, Lord will protect you. You will become supremely dear to him. That is the power of bhakti. If you are a jnani, Lord may or may not protect you. He will ask you, anyway you say that prarabdha, according to prarabdha, everything will happen. You believe so much in karma siddhanta. So whatever that comes to you, you experience as a jnani. Well, this is my prarabdha. Pleasure and pain are one and the same, you experience. So you don't seek the blessings of the Lord when you are a jnani. So you will have to fend for yourself. But when you become a bhakta, he will protect you from all the evil forces in this universe. He will become very dear to you. You will become very dear to him, and for a bhakta, of course, the Lord is very dear to them. There are many stories, the story of Gajendra, we come across in Prahlada, and also the story of, the great story of Kuchela. We have read those stories, we heard those stories many times, the power of devotion. So try to remind yourself of these stories, try to listen to these stories, try to read these stories, a little devotion will be kindled. If you are fortunate enough to get a little devotion awakened in your heart in this birth, You are the most blessed soul on this planet. You are the true billionaire and trillionaire, I tell you. So let's stop here for today.